If I can move on, again, this is a question again from Canada in Ontario, Muzaffar Ahmed Saab from Brampton. I think they may have got sight of the fact that Mehdi Saab was joining us on the panel. So, Jazakallah for your question, Muzaffar Saab. Azhar Saab, if I could come to you with the first question. This is, again, covering something which is very pertinent to every government. It's the issue of tackling crime. We certainly had here a famous quote, Tar Selby Saab will remember, of a former Prime Minister, Mr. Blair, who once said, tackling crime and the causes of crime. And the question from Muzaffar Saab, Jazakallah, reads, eradication and tackling of crime. Lately, it's been a hot topic in the media, and the issue seems to be right at the top of every political agenda. Many people and politicians say that the answer is more legislation, more policing, and surveillance. And this will indeed improve the situation. But the evidence proves that nothing works. What is the Islamic solution to tackling crime and antisocial behavior?
Yes. This is relevant to all of us in every society, no matter where we live. Mm-hmm. We're looking around us now in this day and age, and we must be seeing the rise of delinquency, hooliganism, crime, and the inability of our governments to check the tide of this behavior. Or even when we have implements, systems in place, the jail system, the reform systems, the same individual comes out of those systems and repeats the crime that supposedly he paid the time for and did something to perhaps rectify his thinking that this is not going to be accepted in society. So that is not enough. Merely taking the animals and putting them in the cages in the zoo and throwing the keys away and saying now we have achieved our goal because they're all locked up and the keys are away and we can feel free and safe, I don't think this is the goal of society. It always has been the goal of religions to uplift mankind. And this is something also getting to the issue of crime and punishment in Islam.
Indeed.
You hear, this is a separate question perhaps, but you hear this constant talk of why do you have the punishments in Islam to talk about the cutting of the hands or the capital punishment for certain
But
crimes.
These are quite extremes, aren't they?
These are extremes. But even in these extremes, mm-hmm. before that, your goal is to reform individuals and societies by a body of moral laws, a spiritual consciousness. And if that doesn't exist, there's no law that will stop me from pulling the trigger if I don't fear a moral responsibility. An accountability at the end of that action. That is the greatest deterrent to crime, if you can raise the moral consciousness of a people. And this is why prophets of God are coming to the world.
But knife crime, gun crime, I mean, certainly from the United States, I mean, we here in the United Kingdom, perhaps because of stringent gun laws, it could be argued have prevented the kind of gun crime we see prevalent in the US. I mean, what is the solution? If governments can't legislate, I mean, you picked up on that point of reforming the individual. Is there a step before that as well in terms of society, the society we're creating, the education we're providing?
Yes, perhaps it's not so much what we are providing as so much now what we are not providing. You look in the trends of society these days, I can speak for the Western part of the world I live in the USA. There are more and more jails being erected every single year, built every single year. There are more strict and stringent laws being passed that if you commit a certain act of crime that you're going to be given some leniency, but the second time you're going to be behind bars for life. It hasn't worked.
So two strikes and you're out.
If crime continues to run rampant in society, people are still afraid. They all are buying guns and arming themselves to the teeth in their homes, but no one feels secure. That people are using more and more deadly and violent force to achieve the goal. So what I'm referring to here is not the external forces to control us, it's the internal force. The very nafs that Allah has given us, which either can be subdued or can be excited. And you can say the satanic forces are always trying to excite them, the spiritual forces are always trying to subdue them. And if we can achieve that, we have a peaceful society.
And Tar Saab, if I could come to you just on that, this breakdown of society is talked about and everyone is striving for these solutions. I think, from the question that Muzaffar has asked as well, what is the Islamic answer? What is the crux that of the problem, and indeed what is the solution we can provide. Reform is something very key.
Yeah, I mean, obviously what others have been saying is very true. The fact in this country and all over the world really is that man is moving away from God and man is moving away from religion. Now, of course they may say they believe in God, but they look at God as weak, as powerless, he can't do anything. And so they don't believe that God, they will be answerable to God later on. Likewise, they look at religion, they think, well, religion is all about hate, it's all about terrorism, it's all about instilling fear in people. Mm-hmm. So because they're moving away from this, now where's the moral values? Actually, what religion's all about is instilling those moral values and trying to teach men how to behave in society. And obviously be answerable for that you know that whether you get away with it in this life, you've still got to face God in the next life. So this is something which obviously in the Muslim society we try to instill in our children from day one, that this is the moral values you should be following, this is the Quran, this is the teachings, and you should be aware that God is all around you. Now, of course, if you know that if you believe a policeman is standing right next to you, you're not going to commit a crime.
Indeed.
So if you believe that God is watching over you 24/7, you know, we can't look after children 24/7, but God is there 24/7, constantly watching over, and you'll be answerable for everything you do. So if you can instill this, it's what we call taqwa, the fear of God. When we say fear, the fear of God's displeasure, just like you don't want to cause displeasure of your parents. So likewise, you shouldn't want to cause God's displeasure. So if you can instill that taqwa into the people, and then hopefully they will respond. Now, of course, in Islamic teachings, it's very clear that there are three things that we should do. If we see, for instance, a person attacking, or a group of people attacking a person, what do? These days, there's a tendency to, walk away.
Yeah.
But we should be doing something. So what the Holy Prophet Muhammad has told us is that if you've got the strength, the first thing you should do is physically try and stop them. Of course, the danger is they may turn on you, but that's whether you've got the inner strength. It doesn't mean you've got the physical strength. You've got the inner strength that I want to try and see something. This is dangerous. This is wrong. I need to do something, whatever the consequences of that. If you do fear that you can't have the physical strength, at least you should speak out. Either go to authority or shout or do something, say something. The least thing we should do is that we should not like in our heart. We should pray for the people. Now, the reason for that is that at least you're recognizing the evil. If you just turn away and say, oh, it's nothing to do with me, then of course what you're actually doing is saying, well, that evil's okay. Now the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has beautifully summed this up, that if there's a house on fire and we just ignore that and say, well, it's not my house, why should I worry? That fire can spread and spread until it comes to you. And this is what we're seeing in this society, that unfortunately this is spreading far and wide. Mm-hmm. And it's getting worse. And I really feel for the next generation and the generation after that, that we have to do something. We've got responsibility and we have to instill these moral values into the people. So this is what the Quran teaches. When the Holy Prophet Muhammad saw the society in Arabia at that time, he hated that society. He knew this society had to change. He could have turned away and said, well, it's nothing to do with me. Or he could try and change the society. So this is a duty for every God-fearing person, that they have to recognize that this society has lost God and we have to bring people back to God and follow the religion properly.
And it's recognizing that responsibility.